Welcome to the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl. They played 1 year ago, 140 miles to the south of here. Today, Georgia and Nebraska meet again in the Sunshine State, kicking off 2014 in Jacksonville. Good afternoon, everybody. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham, it's great to have you with us. Janine Edwards will join us shortly. Each one of these teams comes into Jacksonville without their record-setting star quarterbacks. But for Georgia, we will see the future at that position, and it looks like a bright future, too.
When Hudson Mason took over for Aaron Murray, who was injured in the back half of the Kentucky game, everybody knew what this guy brought to the table because he's a fourth-year player in the system. He gets the ball out very quickly. The receivers talk about how you better have your head around or the ball will hit you in the helmet. Now, luckily for Mason, like with Murray, got Todd Gurley back after that midseason ankle injury. This guy is a difference maker. Not 100% yet from that ankle. And in talking to Mike Bobo, the 240-pound Gurley is not quite able to make the cut and have the speed that he had last year. However, during bowl practice, they said he looked as healthy as he's looked than before the Clemson game at the very beginning of the season.
For the Cornhuskers of Nebraska, it has been an up-and-down year, and for head coach Bo Pelini, a volatile year. Janine Edwards has more on that.
Yeah, Mike, to quote Pelini, it's been a long, tough season. And he's not just referring to some of their injuries or losses. It started back in September when an audio tape surfaced of him from 2 years ago bashing the Nebraska fans. Then during their last game of the season, he had a confrontational exchange with an official. After that game, in his press conference, he said, quote, "If they want to fire me, let them fire me." He said the constant speculation about his job status impacted and hurt their football team. He told us it just wouldn't die. I was answering the same questions day after day after day. Well, Pelini finally got resolution when athletic director Sean Eichhorst gave him a vote of confidence. And Pelini said, once it all came to a head, it was great for our program. And we got the feeling that Pelini's extremely bullish on the future of the Cornhuskers. Mike?
Thank you, Janine. And here come the Cornhuskers, 8-4 out of the Big Ten, getting ready to meet the Georgia Bulldogs. Your thoughts?
What, it's amazing when you really drill down. We didn't have Nebraska this year. We had them twice last year. All of the noise around the program, you start thinking, well, is there a problem? But when we talked to Bo Pelini just this week, he was as relaxed and, as Janine said, bullish as I've ever heard him about this program.
Sure was.
After that Iowa loss, they actually had 4 to 5 commitments from big-time recruits. This program, if you look at it, when the Big Ten splits, going into next season, I think you have to put Bo Pelini, Nebraska, at 1A or 1B with Wisconsin on that side of the... They weren't going to fire this guy. This team is trending in the right direction.
The Bulldogs, with all the local support here in North Florida, take the field. We welcome you to 2014, a New Year's Day packed with bowl games. We'll get it rolling from Jacksonville, Florida, coming up next. Welcome back to Jacksonville, Florida, the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl. Before kickoff, we check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, we'll be seeing Tommy Armstrong start today, and he is somebody that the coaches say has, quote, that it factor. The players say he's got that mojo. He's 6-1 as a starter, and that's thanks in part to great vision and making good decisions, the coaches have told us. But they've had to keep the game manageable for him. He's just learning defenses and coverages. That's the one thing that he says he wants to do better today. They say he's just learning. We don't want to give him the fire hose to drink out of. We want to give him a garden hose. Mike?
It's a great way to put it. It makes it very simple to understand.
And Hudson Mason will be making his second start for Georgia, going into spring ball, listed as the number one quarterback. Will be a big deal for this young man. Decided to redshirt last year in 2012 to buy an extra year behind Murray, and it sure looks like that decision is paying off for Mason.
Marshall Morgan has it teed up at the 35. Amir Abdullah and Kenny Bell, both with great speed, are deep for the Huskers. And we are underway from the first coast of Florida. Abdullah from the goal line. Spins out of one tackle, but not a second, taken down at the 18. Johnny O'Neill, nice job on special teams. Nebraska huddling up near the sideline before the offense takes the field. Tommy Armstrong, a record-setting dual-threat quarterback out of the Texas high school system. Played in back-to-back state title games. Anunwa trapped in the backfield trying to turn the corner and can't. Holy cow, what a shot he took from Quincy Mauger.
Well, and the rain has to be a little bit of a factor here, I think, with a young quarterback in Tommy Armstrong who hasn't played much. Remember, he missed the last game against Iowa with an ankle sprain, and Anunwa that time did not look sure on his feet at all. The rain just started about 10 or 15 minutes before the game kicked, so maybe these players not quite used to this because I don't think they had a wet field to warm up on.
Loss of six on the opening play. They nearly botched that handoff. And Abdullah is smothered as he got to the 16-yard line. Georgia being extremely physical on defense its first two plays.
Of course, Nebraska's Taylor Martinez, who was going into his fourth year as a starter, has a foot injury that just never healed. Tried to go a couple of times, and so they've gone with Tommy Armstrong. But early on, I think Georgia being able to be aggressive because you know, with Armstrong, a freshman making his first bowl start, I'm not sure that Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator, is going to call much down the field here with this rain.
His problem has been with accuracy throwing, but he can sure do this. He's an outstanding runner, and he takes it out across the 40 for the first down. So they get out of a hole after a 24-yard scramble for Tommy Armstrong Jr.
And what Tim Beck was telling us about Armstrong, he doesn't have the speed, the breakaway speed that Taylor Martinez has, but has a great feel. Right away, he saw that there was nothing open and that the linebackers had dropped too deep. He does have good speed, but a very good runner in space with good power, too.
Throws on the run, completes it to Anunwa for a gain of about eight. Well, they say he doesn't have breakaway speed. He looks fast enough, doesn't he?
Well, but when you're comparing him to Taylor Martinez, I think that's the biggest thing. And let's see Anunwa going down, making... Look at the feet. Everybody is sliding on this. Remember, this rain just started, so these teams didn't have it during warm-ups. I'm not sure that they're used to it. And sometimes you'll change your cleats, so let's see how some of the traction goes as this game goes on.
Janine, what are you seeing down there?
Well, you know what, guys? About 3 weeks ago, the Jacksonville Jaguars, this is their home stadium, they replaced all the grass in the middle of the field between the hash marks. They did not replace the grass on the outer edges, on the seams. So you'll start to see those outer edges getting very chopped up and slippery today.
All right, thanks, Janine. Edwards after the play fake. Pressured. Still looking for some place to go and throws it out of bounds.
Well, that was a really nice job that time by Armstrong. He was trying to get Kenny Bell to break long. You could see him wave Bell down the field, but nothing there to throw it away. Get yourself to second and 10. A pretty aggressive call now that they get to midfield. Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator, I think, feeling a little better. Maybe things getting settled down. And I think that long run for Armstrong is a good help. It's kind of good to lose your wind a little bit, get that adrenaline out of your system so you can settle in.
Second and 10 for the Huskers. Bell, they like that jet sweep action. What does that do to a defense, Ed, when you always have somebody from speed coming across the face of the formation?
You're half a step slow because you have to think, I may have to burst to my left to chase this, and then you give the inside handoff to Abdullah. And here comes Nebraska with some pace, getting up to the line of scrimmage, and you can see not great blocking, but enough to pick up a few yards.
Georgia shows blitz, motion up front by Nebraska.
Yeah, I think it's Seathan Carter, the true freshman tight end who's been getting a lot of run with Jake Long injured for the better part of the season with a hamstring and an ankle. Young man they expect a lot out of, but that's a big one. You go from third and eight to third and 12 or 13. That's a big penalty.
Everybody gets a little antsy when they see that corner showing blitz. Armstrong and overthrows Anunwa, who ran into double coverage. So Nebraska, after some initial success, will have to kick it away.
Well, let's watch the ball handling between the snapper, Gabriel Miller, who's done a fine job for Nebraska so far this year, a true freshman, and the punter, Sam Fultz. Fultz works as the snapper, or excuse me, the holder and the punter, so has good hands, but not much wet ball work before this game because the rain started when the teams mostly were in the locker room after warmups.
Georgia's special teams have not produced anything in the way of a long return, and this is an awful kick. Straight up and to the right. Fultz, who averages almost 42 yards a kick, shanks one, only 17 yards.
Well, the snap looked perfect from Miller. Just missed it, knew it right away. You know, people say it went off the side of the foot. Almost every punt goes off the side of the foot. It just goes too far off the side of the foot. That's how the ball gets the spin, is actually kicking on the outside, but folks just missed that one.
Hudson Mason is the quarterback out of Marietta, Georgia. He'll toss to Gurley. Georgia likes power football, and Gurley will get a couple. Mason's done pretty well, completing almost 65% of his passes so far. Four touchdowns, two picks. Really gained a lot of confidence in that game against Georgia Tech. They were down 20-0, and he led the comeback when they finally won it in overtime. Gurley again. You may not see the burst from Gurley that you saw last year in his freshman campaign and in the first game this year because that ankle is still bothering.
And you go all the way back to the Clemson game, the 75-yard touchdown run, where if you hadn't seen this guy play as a freshman, you thought, you know, 235, 40 pounds that fast. Strained a hip and a quad during that. Wasn't healthy for a while. Then he sprains his ankle. And the month off helped a bit, but the coach is still not convinced he has his entire burst.
The ankle cost him 3.5 games and cost Georgia valuable positioning. There's a pass that's going to be enough for a first down. Arthur Lynch, the tight end, covered by middle linebacker Michael Rose, and got just enough for the first down.
And Georgia going a little bit fast here. They do have this in their offense, but Mason does a great job in the pocket just waiting for the tight end to clear. And here they do have a hurry up. It is something that Mike Bobo installed a few years ago. And Mason, a guy who in high school operated exclusively in the hurry up. So Mason, a guy who is very comfortable if you go fast.
Well, watch for a play fake trying to take advantage of Andrew Green, number 11, who made that last tackle. When they showed the ball to Gurley, Green just came like a freight train out of the secondary to make the tackle. Gurley on a little delay. Gets to midfield, and it will be third and about six. Michael Rose again in on the stop for the Huskers.
What a gigantic improvement for Nebraska defensively. John Papuchis, the defensive coordinator, second year in that role. We were talking to him, he said, beginning of the season, they're so young up front. There is only one senior in this group. Siante Evans and Gene Baptiste, the seniors on the corner, that the front seven was such a concern, and boy, did they grow as the season went on.
And incomplete, almost a shoe-top catch over the middle. Kenny Towns had a shot and couldn't come up with it. Mason's got a funny little throwing motion, doesn't he?
Yeah, he flicks it a little bit, and this is an inaccurate pass that one of the things that Mike Bobo, who's also the quarterback coach, has been working with Mason, is a little more lower body in the throw, and that ball was just off the mark. They've been working with that friend because he is such a confident guy with his timing, but that one not accurate enough.
Adam Erickson, who has won the punting job, gets it off in Westerkamp, makes a fair catch just outside the 10-yard line. 39-yard kick, no return. Nothing early moments here in Jacksonville.
Well, one of the really nice stories for Nebraska this year was the bursting on the scene of Amir Abdullah. First team All Big Ten, over 130 yards per game. The eighth player in the rich history of Nebraska to have consecutive 1,000-yard seasons. And to put this in context of how great a year it was, this offensive line for Nebraska at times was so beat up with injuries across the entire offensive line. There were times that until after warmups, they didn't know who the starting five was going to be for this offensive line. So really a sensational year when you put into context for Abdullah.
He has put in his name to be evaluated by the NFL, but does not expect to go. He says, I have a lot of academic work ahead.
41 offense, 5-yard penalty, main first down.
But considering the history of Nebraska with tailbacks, boy, they have had just one legendary guy after another.
And this is a guy that, even though he went for 1,000 yards last year in Abdullah, when you watch him on film, he really improved over last year. This year's acceleration is terrific. His vision really has become, and it's really good for 190 pounds. He runs really powerfully between the tackles.
Rain's really coming down now as Armstrong takes the shotgun snap and wants to throw. He's got a Nunwa, and there's going to be an interference call on this play. It looked like Shaq Wiggins had a hold of the jersey for about 10 yards and right at the end gave it a nice little yank.
You know, I was watching Wiggins the entire time because you could see Armstrong loading up for that side of the field, and Wiggins was in
pass, holding number 6 on the defense. The 10-yard penalty results in an automatic first down.
But Wiggins had Anunwa just absolutely step for step playing man to man. You can see the safety playing underneath Quincy Mauger, but right there the left hand is grabbing the jersey, and that's something frankly a lot of defensive backs coach. When you're trailing a guy, if you can sneak that hand in there, but because there was a half yard of separation, you clearly saw that Wiggins was holding,
and you do it and hope to get away with it.
Yeah, well, 10 yards is better than a 50-yard pass on the holding penalty
every time. Abdullah for a couple. The Huskers, as you might expect, very high in the offensive rushing department. They're in the top 20 passing yards, 93rd. It would have been higher if Taylor Martinez had not been injured. He was such a dual threat quarterback. Read option, Abdullah. Nice fake. Used his blocker beautifully, crossed to 30. That'll be a first down and
they're gonna
flag.
Yeah, they're gonna get the defensive end that Armstrong was reading, senior Garrison Smith.
Number 56 on the defense, unnecessarily throwing the quarterback to the ground. 15-yard penalty.
Automatic first down.
Well, the microphone of our referee was breaking up, but the call was unnecessary roughness, and he said that Smith threw down the quarterback unnecessarily. And you saw it there on the tail end. You're always going to be safety aware with quarterbacks. But, you know, to me, if you're Smith, you think the guy has the ball, you're going to make the tackle. I think if you're going to run the read option, you have to let the defensive end who's unblocked go make the tackle. I didn't think that that was unnecessary.
Well, you have to believe that he doesn't know whether the quarterback kept the football or not. He has to make the tackle. That's his job.
And he's behind the guy who is supposedly carrying the ball. There's no way that Smith could have known in that ball exchange that Armstrong didn't have it. And because he has the guy high, he's going to turn and flip him over in a tackling way. That just didn't seem unnecessary. Big gain for Nebraska with a 15-yarder.
Jamal Turner got the last carry, and Abdullah comes back into the ball game. Nebraska operating from its own 48. Armstrong with good time. Now he's flushed. Young man can certainly move and get out of trouble. No wonder they like him so much.
That was a huge, huge break of contain on Ray Drew. The defensive end of that side slipped just slightly. I think this rain is really starting to have an impact on the defensive players as they're going to plant their feet. And Drew, it looked like he was going to break contain anyway. Quarterback was just a bit outside of him, but when 47 went to put his foot in the ground to change direction, he slipped, and that's when Armstrong got away from him.
Third down, call it 5. They'll run the option again. Armstrong, pitch man, was covered up. Beautifully defended by Georgia that time. Armstrong had absolutely nowhere to go. He knew he couldn't keep it. Then he looked, he knew he couldn't pitch it. Floyd. Nice job on the outside.
Got all of the bodies over to that side. You're running an option into the short field. That formation, you're just daring Georgia to line up extra bodies to that side. If you're going to run the option, maybe take it to the field. A pretty conservative call there to run an option into the boundary, the short side of the field with that many bodies. Didn't seem that hard for Georgia to sniff that out.
Fultz, who had a 17-yarder the last time, will kick to McGowan, trying to kick it end over end. Puts it straight up in the air down to the 19-yard line. Only a 32-yard kick this time for Sam Fultz. Nothing, nothing, first quarter.
One point of confidence, the lowest you can get. I think it's going to be a very competitive game, although Michigan State losing Max Bulla, their middle
ball
linebacker,
start.
Being
75
sent home.
Offense.
To me, the difference in that game
remains first down
is the Stanford offense. I think they are both so good defensively. I think that's the only edge in the game.
And Ty Montgomery on the outside for Stanford gives them a little bit of speed to go with that power run game. It'd be a heck of a game.
First and 15 for Mason. Play action fake to Gurley this time, and they'll throw to the tight end. Lynch makes the catch at the sideline, enough for a first down out to the 34-yard line. He beat a good one, Gene Baptiste, the senior corner, for 17 yards.
And Lynch has really stepped up and become a weapon away from the line of scrimmage with all the injuries at wide receiver for Georgia. It's been a nice story his senior year.
Back to what they do best with Todd Gurley. Thing that makes Gurley so tough is he's 235 pounds and he can run. I mean, he has outstanding speed.
It was funny talking to Mike Bobo yesterday. He was looking at the two deep chart and he said 235. He might be up towards 240 by now.
Gurley straight up the middle. Runs over a tackler to the 43.
You know, Janine made a report earlier about the field, how the middle of the field. See all the sand on the back of Gurley? When a field is struggling late in the season, especially at NFL stadiums, there's new grass outside of the hashes, or excuse me, inside, outside of the hashes, old grass, and they pour a bunch of sand in there to try to keep it down. And that, with the rain, I think, can start making it tough when guys get near the sideline to make cuts.
Play action fake to Gurley again. Mason on the run throws it away. Interesting thing about the play action fakes now to Gurley. They have begun to use him so much in the passing game that once you give up on the run and start to bail and go somewhere else, he's out in the pattern.
Well, and the other thing that Georgia does, and we haven't seen yet, is the screen to Gurley, where it looks like Mason's dropping back. They get Gurley set up right around the offensive tackle. They'll also run wide receiver screens, but Gurley not in the game now, but still, this is a big screen team in Georgia.
Four wide receivers here. Instead, they'll give it to J.J. Green, and Green to midfield about 3 yards shy of a first down before Corey Cooper, one of the safeties, makes the tackle.
Well, we were talking about what Bo Pelini had to deal with this year, but for Mark Richt, you lose your two fastest receivers in Malcolm Mitchell and Justin Scott Wesley, your backup running back, very productive guy, and Keith Marshall. All three of those tear an ACL. You also lose a good tight end in Jay Rome. And then, of course, you lose Aaron Murray, your four-year starter quarterback against Kentucky. They have had to overcome a ton.
Mason looks to the right, then goes back to his tight end again, the third catch for Arthur Lynch, who really has good hands. They've started using him a lot more late in the season.
Well, you knew it was going to be a tough year when the fourth offensive play of the season is a 75-yard touchdown run where Gurley pulls a quad and then Malcolm Mitchell, right there, number 26, tears his ACL when he jumps to celebrate after that touchdown. Gurley was not 100% the rest of that game, and Malcolm Mitchell's one of the fastest guys in the country. So to lose a guy like Mitchell on the fourth offensive play and your top eventual first-round running back goes out with a, well, not out, but was slowed. It just, you knew this was going to be a tough year for Georgia.
Well, if you believe in omens, that was it.
And yet, they go and they beat South Carolina, they beat LSU, two top 10 teams, and got right back into the mix for conversation for obviously the SEC championship, but potentially the BCS title before things really kind of fell apart in the middle of the season with injuries.
Yeah, I'm not sure their defense was up to the standard that would lead them to a national title, but without those injuries, I think you're sure looking at least a one-loss team and somebody who's in the conversation.
And something that Mike Bobo, the offensive coordinator, and the entire offensive staff, they had to rebuild kind of this entire offense. They lost all of their speed at receiver. They just don't have that speed on the outside. They became more of a shotgun, ball handling, screen type of team, and really manufactured a nice offense down the stretch.
Third and long from the Nebraska 41. Mason under pressure, and down he goes. Randy Gregory, the most sought after junior college prospect in years, in his first year at Georgia, and that's why everybody wanted him.
Well, you cannot, if you're Canarius Gates, you cannot lose this man to the inside. And Gates was actually going for a cut block and went cross body. When you go for a cut block, you have to keep your head up, get your hands on the ground when you're playing up against a guy who is as gifted athletically as Gregory.
Westerkamp signals for a fair catch and makes it at the 10. 37-yard punt, and the sack by Randy Gregory, which is 10.5 on the season for him, shuts down a Georgia drive and keeps it nothing-nothing. Those are scenes from yesterday's pep rally at Jacksonville Landing here in Jacksonville. Both teams attended that.
Well, you've mentioned we're in the Sunshine State. I haven't seen sunshine yet. I've been here for 3 days. Oh, the temperature's been great.
Yes, it has. Nebraska averaging less than 2 yards of play on first down, and that's about what they got on that one. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, guys, it's a light rain out here, but a steady rain, and the Nebraska Cornhuskers are making some adjustments. First of all, they're going through tons and tons of gloves. All the offensive players came off the field and took all their gloves off and swapped them out for these with the tacky suede palms. Also, several guys have asked to change their shoes, their cleats, from the molded cleats to the longer cleats. And a difference in the footballs that these teams are using for this game. Georgia has used rubber-laced footballs, whereas Nebraska is using the cloth-laced footballs. Supposedly, I'm told that the rubber-laced footballs are a little bit better for grip in wet conditions.
All right, we'll see who might have an advantage there, Janine. And Nebraska trying to go for it on third down, the short yardage situation. And Georgia stopped them about a yard shy of a first down. Here comes the punt unit.
And that's a second third down in a row where Nebraska was exceedingly conservative. And I know that the inside run game has worked for them, but they have a guy in Tommy Armstrong who handles the ball well, can get it on the edge. They ran an option into the boundary with an overshifted personnel last time, and this one was just a dive up the middle.
Fultz to kick to McGowan. Bobbled it, but got it back at the 41. Punt of 40 yards, and again, really good field position for Georgia to start.
You know, if you have not put on a pair of football gloves in the last 15 or 20 years, it's hard to explain how tacky they really are. And I don't mean that they're out of fashion.
Right.
I just mean that they stick together quite a bit, although I've seen some that are out of fashion. But when they start to get wet, that chemical that they put on the surface of those starts to become ineffective. So Nebraska being very aggressive, changing their shoes, using a different ball. We've seen a lot of slipping so far, so we'll see how that pans out as the game goes on.
Hudson Mason has Gurley to his left. Gurley out in the pattern, and they're throwing for it. Get the big guy in space and let him do his thing. Takes it to the Nebraska 40, a gain of 19.
And this is something that the offensive staff has worked extremely hard, is getting number three involved in the run game. Here he's going to end up one-on-one with a linebacker, Michael Rose. And a nice little move. Rose just has no chance to keep up with the speed of Gurley. That's something, if you're Mike Bobo, you put a little check mark next to that play.
Gurley back at his more traditional spot, 7 yards behind the line of scrimmage. And Mason under center. Gurley with the carry. David Santos makes the stop on the last play of the first quarter at the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl. It's nothing, nothing. Welcome back to Jacksonville. Nothing, nothing into the first quarter.
Mike, how many pull-ups did you get in the pregame pull-up competition?
Got in a couple.
These are some new Marine recruits who just were sworn in.
Central Florida and Baylor. Art Briles will send out Bryce Petty, that nation's leading offense. They'll go into the desert against number 15 Central Florida. Blake Bortles will lead that club on offense. And a lot of people asking, will Art Briles be going somewhere?
He's an awfully, from the moment I covered Art Briles when he was at Houston, I've covered him a few times at Baylor. He's one, I put him in that Chip Kelly category. Just has such a bright mind. The kids really respond to him. I think he's a terrific coach.
Play action fake, and it's Bauta, the backup quarterback, who starts this series, a redshirt freshman, Fatone Bauta. And they say he has the lead going in as the incumbent backup for next season.
But the first guy they have who is really athletic at that position in the Mark Richt era. A little strange though, on second and seven on the plus side of the field. They had a plan for Bauta, it just seemed like a strange play to bring him in on.
Gurley trying to get to the sticks, just a little bit shy as Jason Ankra was able to drag him down short of the marker.
Well, you're at a ball game, you're on the 31-yard line, it's raining. I would imagine Gurley would be a good call here on fourth and short.
Crowd starting to get into it here. Fourth and short, they go for it. Gurley. Now he stretched
wow.
The ball. The question is going to be, was his knee down before he got the ball to the 30-yard line?
Thad Randall, a senior for Nebraska, did an excellent job on Dallas Lee, the left guard. Watch number 64 get stood up as 53 Randall comes in. You see a linebacker coming in, Santos.
Whew.
If Gurley doesn't stretch, and I'm not sure that they're not going to review this.
I think he made it.
I believe he did too. Let's see if any part of his body goes down. The line to make is right there. Yeah, he made it.
He got it.
Yeah, good spot. Good effort by Randall though.
The running back is Douglas, trying to rotate three guys in and out of it to keep Gurley fresh, so he's good to go in the fourth quarter. And Mason has to scramble and just gets back to the line of scrimmage.
And this actually is a really nice job by Mason. Last week against Georgia Tech, early in the game, he had a couple of pockets that were fine, and he just would bail out. He just was trying to see too many things. That pocket was starting to collapse. There was nobody open. So instead of taking a loss, at least he was getting up into the pocket and trying to get positive yards. Second 10 is better than second 15 any day.
Ran a fast-paced offense in high school, something they may do more of next year. Douglas gets the carry, picks up a couple. Zaire Anderson on the stop for Big Red.
This defensive front for Nebraska, and when we were talking to Bo Pelini and John Papuchis, his defensive coordinator, this is a group, this front seven, that got pushed around the beginning of the season. Very young, very inexperienced. They love the talent they've brought in. We've already seen the impact of Randy Gregory, but they had a bye week. They had Illinois and Purdue, two teams that they were frankly better than and beat. Then another bye week, and coming out of that, they said this defensive front looks like as good as they'll have had here over the next couple of years, and that's saying something.
Third and eight over the middle to Lynch, the tight end again, open in the middle of the field, down to the 17-yard line. That's his fourth catch here in the first half. He only had 24 for the regular season.
And Mason gets another good pocket and does another good job working the pocket. He comes all the way back to Lynch. This was his second or third read, and now Mason on the run.
Mason made a great decision. Had a lot of room to run. He could have gotten more, except Rantavius Wooten, his wide receiver out there, was getting ready to get in position to get him a block and simply lost his footing and fell down.
It's happening a lot on the edge of the field. Middle of the field's brand new turf. The outside has been through an entire NFL season. We've had some rain. There's a lot of sand in the base there. The footing not good on the outside for either team.
Gurley near the 10. They need to reach the 8-yard line.
This to me feels like
change.
This to me feels like the way Lynch is playing at that tight end spot. Because it's third and short, maybe you look at a play action with Gurley and try to slip out. Lynch at 6'5", 254 pounds.
This will be the 11th play of the drive. Mason flushed. Can't get away, and then that could easily be intentional grounding. He just appeared to throw it at the feet of a Nebraska rusher.
And the officials all getting together, and they're going to call it. Now, I liked how they come together. What did you see?
Intentional grounding, offense. The quarterback was in the pocket, and there were no eligible receivers in the area.
Well, that pretty much covered it all, didn't
it? Yeah, it sure did. But it's just like a sack. So now it's fourth down. The one thing, if you're going to coach Mason up, as it's a terrific rush by Greg McMullen. McMullen, one of the only defensive ends giving some depth with the suspension of Avery Moss. Moss not here for the bowl game for Nebraska. That was a nice job by McMullen.
He's just got to learn to get rid of
that
ball.
Or just take the sack, because you're still in field goal range. That's a really dangerous play to just throw the ball into the air. Who knows if it gets picked up or anything. It's just a dangerous play.
Marshall Morgan, first team All-SEC kicker. 18 out of 20 this year. And he puts his high-powered Georgia offense on the board, finally, with 10:37 to go. Second quarter, Bulldogs up by a field goal. November 23rd was a sad day for Georgia fans. Aaron Murray's career came to an end just over 4 minutes left against Kentucky in the first half. He was thrown to the ground, torn the ACL in his left knee, underwent surgery. What a brilliant career. Set 4 SEC records, including touchdown passes, yardage. He was the first quarterback ever to throw for over 3,000 yards 4 years in a row. And yet, I never thought he got the credit nationally that he deserved.
And I think when the NFL scouts, he'll be fine. Come June, July, ACL surgeries are really routine and pretty easy to come back from now. Come June, July, he'll be ready to compete with an NFL team. But I think when NFL scouts are studying the tape, what he did this year with all of the injuries they had, especially at receiver and running back, to manufacture what he did on offense against this level of competition is extraordinary.
Bell on the return breaks it to the outside with that speed up across to 35, and here's Janine.
Nice enough to stick around in the ring to talk to us. Mike Tucker just
obviously having some technical problems on the sideline with that microphone. We'll get another one and get back to Janine and Aaron Murray.
And we get our first look at Ron Kellogg, the senior who started the last game of the season for Nebraska. The coaches said they would definitely get him some reps in this game, being his last game as a Husker.
His first play is a handoff to Abdullah, who takes it out to the 39-yard line. Ron Kellogg, the third out of Omaha. His only start, he struggled in the loss to Iowa, but he will always be remembered for winning that Northwestern game with that Hail Mary.
And he was a guy who was adding some depth. Of course, Taylor Martinez goes down with that foot injury early in the season, and then Tommy Armstrong has an ankle sprain against Penn State.
Fake to Abdullah, and a smart decision by Kellogg to throw it away. As he got drilled, Garrison Smith was putting on the pressure.
That was a nice job by Kellogg. He's not the runner that Armstrong nor Martinez is. But I think Tim Beck on third down has been a little conservative. Don't be surprised with a draw here to Abdullah.
I wouldn't be. The question is, will the Georgia defense be surprised? And they don't do it. Pressure coming. Hit as he throws. The ball falls harmlessly. And they brought the house. You see a new quarterback, let's come after him and see how he reacts to it. And Jordan Jenkins, number 59, was coming from his outside linebacker spot. And did they unload on Kellogg?
Left tackle just a little slow. Brett Qualley, one of the many injured players from Nebraska up front, an ankle injury for Qualley, but he was awfully slow out of his stance. And Todd Grantham, the defensive coordinator, knew that they could get some edge rush against these hobbled tackles for Nebraska.
Loose ball, still loose. Cornhuskers recover. Reggie Davis bobbled the ball. It's a muff. He never had possession. Lost it at the 14-yard line. Josh Mitchell with the recovery. What a break for Nebraska. Unforced error.
Overran the ball a bit. One of the hardest things when you're catching punts is when the ball starts to move. He's running to his right. Davison, as the ball came back to the middle of the field, sometimes balls that have a tight spiral will actually drift in the other direction. And just a huge break for Nebraska.
Armstrong back in at quarterback. First and 10 from the 14 for Georgia. Armstrong on the option, pitch to Abdullah. Made a great cut, picks up about 9 yards.
What a nice block by Jake Long. Another one of the walk-in wounded for Nebraska. Long, whose brother, Spencer Long, who's out with a knee injury, who was their best offensive lineman. Abdullah slips a little bit, but Long pushes his man right by, and that's right what Abdullah cut underneath.
Boy, did they clear up that left side. For the end zone, Anunwa, touchdown. The official wanted to make sure he had possession, walked over, and then gave us the signal. Nice play action fake by Tommy Armstrong Jr. on first, on second down and one.
Wow, it's going to be awfully close. I saw the tip of the ball headed for the grass, and I'm sure that we're going to get a review of this. I'd be really surprised if they don't stop it and review it. Looked to me like the tip of the ball may have touched the grass, and this is something I think you have to review. Well, remember, they do review every play as it's going on, so they didn't stop it. So the review officials here from the Pac-12 obviously okay with that catch.
We'll take a look if we have to when we come back. He certainly had his arms under the ball from that angle. Touchdown, Anunwa. Quincy Anunwa has just tied a school record, the 11th touchdown reception in a season, tying the great Johnny Rogers, set that record in 1971.
Well, it's obvious that Tommy Armstrong very comfortable with Anunwa. He's gone to him several times. Still not convinced he caught that thing, but a little surprised we didn't get the review.
J.J. Green is the deep man as Nebraska takes advantage of the muff punt. Green 3 yards deep. He'll bring it out. Has a seam up the middle, then cuts it to the outside. Green to the 48-yard line. Heck of a return by J.J. Green.
Green's a young man that they really didn't know what position he was going to play. They recruited him as an athlete, and with all the injuries, especially at running back with Keith Marshall, he had to go to running back. And the coaches talked about when they studied him in high school, he wasn't the flashiest guy. He always didn't outrun everybody, but every time that he needed to make a play, be it as a cornerback or a running back or a wide receiver, he always did a big play in the special team.
And Georgia's special teams finally get a big return. They have not had a long punt or kickoff return all year until just now. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, Mike, I'm here with Aaron Murray, and you summed up his career earlier as brilliant, and I think we would agree with that. Aaron, when you think back on your 4 years at Georgia and everything that you were able to accomplish, what's the one thing that stands out to you? What are you most proud of?
Just how much fun I've had. It really has been an unbelievable experience to be part of such a great university, a great program with some great coaches and some great friends, some friends I'll have for the rest of my life. And like I said, I really did cherish these past 4 years and looking to be a Dog for the rest of my life now.
How would you describe this season? Kind of an emotional roller coaster, and here you are, would have been your final game of your career. You're watching from the sideline.
It's crazy. It's a unique experience to be here on the sideline watching and not being in there with my guys, but it was fun. I mean, at the end of the day, every single game pretty much came down to the last quarter, the last play, the last drive. So it was exciting. We had some huge wins versus South Carolina and LSU and some fun ones versus Auburn. So it was a great year. Obviously, it wasn't the year we expected, but at the end of the day, you know, like I said, had a lot of fun.
Give us a quick scouting report on Hudson Mason. He's a guy that has sat behind you for 4 years now. You know him pretty well.
Oh, he's tremendous. He's a heck of a ball player. You know, he's going to be great. He really did a great job of listening to everything I told him, getting the reps when he was able to get the reps. And the biggest thing with Hudson is during the week, he treated Monday through Friday as his game week. You know, he took practice very seriously, and I think that's why he's been able to come in here early on versus Georgia Tech and then this game and been so successful, you know, his first two games.
Well, he learned from one of the best. Thanks for your time, Aaron. All the best to you.
Thanks for having me.
Janine, thank you very much. Aaron, thank you. And the Georgia screen game comes alive. Douglas with the opportunity to play this series. Anunwa out in the flat, and just as fortunate that that was incomplete because it would have lost yardage as Josh Mitchell came up from the corner.
Well, this is Rumpf, who's been battling a hamstring. They weren't sure how much they were going to be able to get out of him the play before. Excuse me, this is the play before. Excellent job by Chris Burnett downfield, but the safety Cooper from Nebraska had bailed out. He has to come up and force that. That is not what John Papuchas, defensive coordinator, wants. He needs a safety coming up to force that.
Douglas lowers his shoulder, gets to about the 11. That last swing pass, by the way, intended for Rumpf.
And Douglas, a guy at close to 210 pounds. We've already seen J.J. Green gives him a little bit of flash behind Gurley, getting Gurley some rest here. But Douglas, a true freshman, they expected to have to get into the game some, but of course, when Keith Marshall went down, he became a bigger part of the plan.
Third and six for Mason. All day to throw, lost it to the corner and incomplete. Intended for Rhett McGowan, but he got turned around with Ciante Evans in the back corner. And this will bring on the field goal unit.
That play just took forever to get going. Nebraska plays a lot of matchup zone that ends up being just straight man-to-man, and there was nobody open. But the pretty good job by this offensive line, a veteran group for Georgia. They've been giving pretty decent pockets for Mason when he needs them.
So that'll bring on Marshall Morgan, who was already hit from 38. This will be a 28-yard attempt. And he is true again. Marshall Morgan, 20 for 22 this season and 15 straight. No wonder he's all conference. Look here at the Gator Bowl parade that started here at EverBank Field, finished in downtown Jacksonville. 7-6 ball game with 6:53 to go, first half. Both teams come in 8-4, 5-3 in their respective conferences. Hopes for better records dimmed certainly on both ball clubs by injuries. Newby and Bell are deep. Bell from the two. Taken down shy of the 25-yard line, and Nebraska will start from there.
Well, let's go back to the drive before. You know, there was the call earlier on Garrison Smith for a hard hit on Armstrong from Nebraska, the quarterback. And here, right at the end, that's I don't think you throw it. And then the Nebraska staff was a little upset because the guard, Brandon Caplano, pushed down on Gregory there at the end. But that was awfully close to a penalty on Gregory. I don't think it should be called, but when you call the one earlier on Garrison Smith, I think you have to be consistent and at least consider throwing that flag for roughing the passer.
Abdullah on first down will pick up 4, maybe 5 yards out to his own 28.
This offensive line for Bo Pelini and offensive coordinator Tim Beck. All of the guys, almost every player up on this front line is one play away from a nick and having to come out of the game. Not a lot of depth behind them either.
Abdullah straight up the middle. Can be stopped about a yard shy of the sticks, so it'll bring up third and one.
Now, there's been just so much trouble on the edge of the field for the defenses to plant and get to the outside. Maybe this is something you get wide for Abdullah, and see, is such a good, if you can get him to the outsides here where it's slick and it's some kind of a toss sweep and he makes a good cut, could be there.
Only one out of five on third down so far. They'll keep it inside, and Abdullah looks like they're gonna mark it at least a half yard past the line to make, so it will be a first down.
Have you seen a guy with 190 pounds hit the line that hard?
No, he's impressive.
He really is. I was working in the studio during the bowl break with Robert Smith, who obviously is a pretty good running back who works for us as an analyst, and he really likes this guy. He described him as a snake with legs. He just slithers through holes. He has a great, the first and second step after he sees the hole are long and explosive. I when studying this guy, Abdul, I'm really impressed.
Really, the only knock on him throughout his entire career has been fumbling. He's lost 15 fumbles in his career. That's a ton.
Yeah. It's fixable. A lot of times it's a mechanical thing. Carry the ball down by your hip, it's going to come out. You get it up across your chest. I always look at what Kiki Barber did when he was a running back with the
That's
Giants.
For sure.
had just an awful bout of fumbles and completely restructured how he carried the ball. And it's something that Abdullah has not had much trouble with this year.
It is the first down. Imani Cross checks in as the tailback. Went the wrong way. Then came back, and they go to Seathan Carter.
And Nebraska.
Well, they botched the play in the backfield. It messed up the timing, but Armstrong kept his concentration.
I'm not sure that Imani Cross did not move before the snap. I think if he goes sideways, it's okay, as long as he's not making a move towards a line of scrimmage. But I mentioned earlier, Carter, a guy that the Nebraska offensive staff, very excited, got a lot of time because of the injury to Jake Long. You see, Jake Long, excuse me, has the ability in the middle of the field to make the play.
Spot the ball at the Georgia 44, first and 10. Fake the fly sweep to Turner. Armstrong with all day to throw. Throws late, completes it to Bell. Somehow that ball got through a couple of defenders. Quincy Mauger was right there. He thought it was his.
When Armstrong let this go, I was watching the coverage, and there was nobody open, including Bell. There were three guys closing into the area. Armstrong gets a good weight transfer, but Mauger late getting over there in the corner. That's, the safety, Corey Moore, also late. Boy, did he fit that in.
Abdullah.
And one guy that's missing for Georgia, Josh Harvey Clemens, who was suspended for breaking team rules, is a huge loss, especially with a team that has a running back like Abdullah. Harvey Clemens, a guy with some size, can go out in space. And we were talking to Todd Grantham. He thought that was going to be a huge miss for this Georgia defense that has had its struggles this year.
I mean, he was a big safety, 215 pounds.
He could play in space, could come off the edge. That's a big loss for this game.
Fake to Turner, keep by Armstrong. Nothing there. Good play by Garrison Smith to stay home. It fits the rest of your offense, that fakes fly sweep.
It's awesome.
Try saying that three times real fast. Really seems to have an effect on defenses that you want. Third and six.
Timeout, Georgia. That's their first charge timeout.
And Georgia will use its first timeout of the half with 3:34 to go on a third and six. Well, in the BCS, we get what we wanted. Number one, number two in the Vizio BCS National Championship. Florida State, led by Heisman winner Jameis Winston, looking to complete its undefeated season in style. Trey Mason and the Tigers aim to finish their remarkable ride to Pasadena. The Vizio BCS National Championship, Florida State Auburn. Coverage begins next Monday at 8 o'clock on ESPN. Our congratulations to Jimbo Fisher for his new contract, well earned, as he has brought this program back not just to championship form, but perhaps national championship form. Armstrong with good protection, throws to the corner and bobbled and dropped by Turner. Holy cow, he was wide open, and Armstrong put it right on the numbers. Got to his body, bounced off his chest.
This ball was in the air for a long time. Turner, a guy who they weren't even sure if he was going to be able to play. He's missed the better part of five games. And that ball, how many times have we seen that during bowl season where a ball hangs in the air and hangs in the air? Oh, and boy, did Armstrong put that right where it needed to be.
Actually tried to catch it with his hands and pulled it into his body, bounced it off his chest and lost it. Pat Smith will come on to try a 46-yard field goal. That would be his longest of the season. Plenty of distance. And Pat Smith knocks it through. He's only missed once this year, and that was from 48. So both of these place kickers have had outstanding seasons. And the Huskers with a little breathing room at 10-6. 3:18 left, first half from Jacksonville. Pat Smith on the sidelines. Hudson Mason waiting his turn. 3:18 to go, first half. J.J. Green is deep, who had that outstanding return last time. Georgia comes in 119th in the country in kickoff returns. Green with more room to run up the middle again past the 25. We check in with John Saunders. John.
Well, happy new year, guys. Coming up at halftime, Mark May and Lou Holtz will join me. Johnny Football, if you didn't see it, where were you? We'll show you and get you up to date. It's also an extremely big day because the Rose Bowl, the granddaddy of them all, the 100th anniversary, plus the Big Ten. Not only the Rose Bowl, but they could have a huge day with some wins today. It's all coming up at halftime. Back to you, Mike.
All right, John, and happy new year to you, my friend. Starting from the 25, Hudson Mason brings them out. Gurley is the tailback. They'll send him out in the flat and throw to Gurley.
Well, George,
I'll tell you what, I'd do that about 30 times a game, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but if I'm the Nebraska coaches, I'm saying, hey, Rhett McGowan, the receiver to that side, just cleared out the entire side of our defense to get Gurley there. He was running a route, but I wouldn't be surprised if Nebraska coaches complain about a pick. But, you know, one thing to keep in mind here is Hudson Mason, because Aaron Murray, the four-year starter who got hurt against Kentucky, second to last game of the year, because Murray had so much experience, Mason actually ran the hurry-up drill every Thursday in practice this season. So he's had a ton of reps in this exact situation.
And it's the kind of offense he ran in high school. Again, Gurley off the left side across the 40. You can tell if you've seen him before, he is not 100%. No. That ankle is still bothering him.
And with two timeouts,
he's still out there gutting it out.
Yeah, you can see that ankle's not quite there. He seems to be walking a little gingerly on it. He gets into a groove as the game goes on, but boy, this is awfully slow for Georgia. Under 3 minutes with two timeouts. That took a lot of time for that play.
This one thrown downfield to midfield to Chris Connolly, another injured player. He aggravated an ankle injury on Saturday. They weren't sure whether he'd be able to go in this game, and if he could, for how long. and he is their leading receiver in terms of both catches and yards, so he's critical to their offense.
And it was in last year's bowl game, the Outback, Georgia, Nebraska, and it was long throws, some to Connolly, that really were the difference in that game. None of those so far in this one.
That was the first catch by a Georgia wide receiver. They wanted to set up a screen, couldn't do it. They end up coming back to Michael Bennett. That was a good job by Mason, because they, and there's pushing and shoving after the play, a lot of it.
Yeah, and there's been a little bit of a tussle. There's been a couple of times where Randy Gregory, the all Big Ten first year defensive end out of junior college, and there Nebraska needs to be careful. Gurley, and that looks to me
Josh Mitchell.
Yeah, Josh
literally
Mitchell
had to be dragged away from a confrontation.
He's got to be careful. But it started with Gregory, the defensive end, who had gotten into it a bit on the last drive, but and took away from a nice job by Michael Bennett to get out of bounds after that catch. Saved a lot of clock or a timeout.
No flags.
And because we're inside of 2 minutes, the clock will not start because Bennett went out of bounds. I didn't see anything. I was watching the whole scuffle. I saw no punches thrown, so
no.
Good idea just to separate the guys, get them settled down. But the next time there's a push, don't be surprised if a flag comes out.
Mason, pressure coming up the middle, throws deep sideline again to his tight end, Lynch. Lynch has been very, very active. That ball hung in the air quite a while. I'm sure Lynch is thinking, come on, get here.
Well, we already saw Jamal Turner for Nebraska drop what looked like a sure touchdown for a ball that hung in there. Mason falling back a little bit. You know, that's one of the things the coaches are working with. Even with pressure, you got to step in, but got the ball out on time. That's the one thing Mason does. He may not step into every throw, but he threw the ball before Lynch came out. Lynch really, really good body control for a big player.
The tailback is Green, and they'll give it to him. Trying to use that speed, gets to the 21.
And now Nebraska needs to start thinking about some timeouts here. They've got all three. You know that Georgia's in line for at least a field goal. Maybe not here on second down, but I think after third, you'd probably start thinking about a timeout.
Green hit almost immediately, got the ball in his hands, and Jean Baptiste was up from the corner to mess up the timing of the play, and then got a lot of help from his teammates.
And Georgia seeming to be they're lining up, but boy, a lot of clock has run off for Georgia. I know it's third and long, but if you pick up the first, now you're going to be battling the clock to see if you can get any throws into the end zone. They have wasted a ton of time on this play and on a previous play. This is not good management here.
Approaching 30 seconds. Three-man rush, swing to Green. Lost his footing, gets back to the 21-yard line.
And now if you're Nebraska, you're going to be sitting here with, I mean, if I am Georgia, I let this go all the way down to 1 second before I call my timeout. And for Nebraska, you're going to go into the half with three timeouts in your pocket and no chance to put your offense back on the field.
This will be a 30-second charge timeout.
So the field goal unit will come out.
Yeah, that's one of the things you go into the offseason. If you're Mike Bobo, this would be a huge learning experience. You can put the game clock, you can see the frustration for Mason, but I think at times there they were their own worst enemy. That third down, they probably should have had somewhere around a minute left on the clock, but they got it all the way down into under 18 seconds. And this is something that Mike Bobo, they're getting a stretch before he goes down for halftime, that you can work on in the offseason and just show those precious seconds that roll off. And of course for Nebraska, you get no chance to go on offense.
Morgan already connected from 28 and 38. This will be another 38-yard try out of the hole of Adam Erickson.
Prior to the snap, timeout, Nebraska. That's their first charge timeout. This will be a 30-second charge timeout.
Well, they got to use one of them.
Well, and let's see if they use the other two.
Capital One Bowl Week will continue with the grad daddy of them all, number 4 Michigan State, led by Connor Cook, against Tyler Gaffney, and number 5 Stanford, looking for back-to-back Rose Bowl titles. Our coverage starts at 4:30 Eastern on ESPN, part of Capital One Bowl Week, the Rose Bowl, number 4 against number 5. If you like defense, you're going to love that game. Marshall Morgan, vastly improved from an inconsistent freshman year. He's the all-SEC kicker. And hooks it just inside the right post. 3 field goals in the first half for Marshall Morgan. And we have a 1-point ball game. The Bulldogs with all their points on Morgan field goals. Let's go to Janine.
Bo, I know the weather has kept your equipment guys busy. How much has it impacted your play calling?
No, not at all. I mean, it's not that bad out here. I mean, it's got a little bit of, you know, obviously the ball's a little bit wet. It's not too bad out here, and it's not impacted anything that we do.
Well, you know, Georgia's going to come out in the second half wanting to make a statement, and we're already seeing tempers flaring out there on the field. What's your message going to be to your team right now?
Come out ourselves and make a statement. That's what we're looking to do.
Thanks, Bo.
Thank you, Janine. At the half, our score, Nebraska 10, Georgia 9. Now we'll send you to John Saunders for our halftime show. John? Welcome back to the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl. Jacksonville, Florida. Nebraska holding a 10-9 lead over the Bulldogs of Georgia. Georgia was able to move the ball in the first half up and down the field, but they had to settle for field goals. They got 3 of them. But they can't seem to punch it across.
And I think the biggest thing for them and inside that kind of 20 and in is Todd Gurley's health. He just doesn't look like the same guy we saw last year or earlier in the year against Clemson. So for Hudson Mason, I think it's got to come to the screen game. They're missing all of their vertical threats in the pass game, which was how Georgia beat Nebraska last year in the Outback Bowl. So I think for Mason, it's about getting the other guys involved in the screen game around the line of scrimmage, because they just don't have their 240-pound bruising tailback at 100% right now.
Georgia gets the ball first. See what kind of halftime adjustments they may have made. And their drive chart, you don't see a drive over 54 yards. And you see the result of 3 of the 5 drives, field goals.
And give some credit, really, to Nebraska defensively. This front 7, it's hard to put into context how much better they got over the year, over the season. Of course, a lot of true freshmen out there right now is Malik Collins. But they have gotten so much bigger in the middle. Vincent Valentine's a guy who stepped up. Don't take away what this front 7 has done and the improvement they've made over the season for Nebraska either.
Mason under pressure, sidearms it to Gurley. What a play just to keep it alive. He threw it between two guys who were after him. Thad Randall nearly had him.
Great job by the defensive front. Randall, you know, you get stuck in that place. What a side flip throw. Again, a little bit dangerous. Remember that throw earlier when he got called for intentional grounding, but he's able to slip that in. Good recognition, though, by the front for Nebraska.
And Gurley has good hands. Blitz coming. Mason to Gurley, and on cue, he dropped the ball.
Something they worked really hard on with Gurley. Obviously, a sensational back when fully healthy. But when they lost Malcolm Mitchell, their fastest receiver, Justin Scott Wesley, who, if it was a 100-meter race, would probably beat Malcolm Mitchell. He's a 10-200 meter guy, and they just lost all the vertical stretch of the wide receivers that they had going into the season. So Gurley's had to pick up the slack in the pass game.
4-man rush. Mason with a lot of time throws it right to a defender, Josh Mitchell, with the interception. And Mitchell slides in safely at the 38. The 14th interception for that defense.
And we earlier in the game, we saw Mason have a tough time with the ball coming out, being a little bit wobbly and getting off track. One thing that they've worked on, he's had some accuracy issues. But this ball just seemed to really float to the inside. Good physical coverage that time by Josh Mitchell. And he's going up against the gimpy Chris Connolly. I'm not so sure Connolly, because of that injury and the good physical coverage by Mitchell, that was more to do than the throw being off by Mason.
Tommy Armstrong, the third, gives it off to his tailback, and Abdullah plows forward. Remember that Nebraska's only touchdown came as the result of a break, a muffed punt deep in Georgia territory. So can they take advantage of another turnover? Perfect throw to the sideline, Nunwa. Excellent timing by Armstrong.
They really like Armstrong. They feel like they've been working in the throw game. He's over under 50% on the season, but when his timing is good and he steps into his throws, he's able to deliver it. Good protection up front and pretty good safety play over the top by Corey Moore, but a good throw and catch for Nebraska.
You've got to get that ball there in a hurry, or that guy's really going to get lit up. Carry by Westerkamp. And he's pushed back after getting down to around the 13-yard line.
And this is a Georgia defense that lost a ton of guys. Two first-round linebackers last year to the NFL. Eight guys had to be replaced.
Seven of them drafted. That's unbelievable. Yeah.
And Floyd, a guy that they expect big things out of, but this is a defense that has had its struggles this year. They've made a few plays in games like South Carolina and LSU when they needed them, but this is a growing year for Todd Grantham. No doubt that this defense has not been completely up to the Georgia standard that they've set in the previous two seasons.
Fake to Westerkamp. He was open in the flat for a minute, still is. Armstrong with the fake gets down to the 10-yard line, wrapped up by Ray Drew, the defensive left end.
You know, this is a place where you could look for Anunwa. Seems to have a good feel. He's a bigger receiver. The corners for Georgia, not huge guys. Anunwa lined up to the right. Over on this side, he's coming. He's moved in. Look for him maybe to run something to the corner or outside potentially.
Third and five. Georgia showing press coverage on the outside. The slant over the middle, incomplete, intended for Bell. The penalty is going to be called on Damian Swan, the boundary corner. He had the coverage on Bell, and there was contact.
Pass. Number five on the. I'll be placed. Automatic first down.
Quick slant to the left. They had motion over there. Yeah, Swan just never let go of him. He had great position. If he just lets go, I don't think that they call that. You're allowed to make that contact. Just never let him go.
First and goal. Abdullah. No signal yet. He's at the goal line, and they are going to mark him just short.
This guy for 190 pounds runs so well. Gets down low. He accelerates through the tackle. Good stop there by Georgia.
Keeper, no signal, but it didn't look like he got there, and the ball came out late. Officials are going to say progress was stopped. And it will be third and goal. So they tried to go quickly.
Yep. And now I don't think that if you're Nebraska, think of something on the edge here. Armstrong is such a good zone read. He can run an option. This, I don't think you want to run between the tackles necessarily.
Abdullah touchdown. Came in seventh in the country in yards per game, and if you haven't seen him before, you can tell why. He is a good one.
Well, they ran that fly sweep fake to Kenny Bell, and it froze the linebackers, and that looked like a much better block up front on that left side. Jake Cotton, Brent Qualley, these are all guys. Pensick, the center, all guys for Nebraska are battling some type of lower leg, either ankle or knee injury on this offensive line, playing well.
Smith for the point after. Both touchdowns coming after turnovers. And it's 17-9. The Huskers over the Bulldogs as Abdullah caps that drive. Nebraska over Georgia with 10:08 to go, third quarter. The TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl from Jacksonville, Florida, playing in the rain, about 62 degrees.
I feel like it's a big drive for Mark Richt. The way Abdullah ran on that drive, they can't get a score here. Nebraska gets the ball back and gets that run game going and gets up two scores in the rain. And the struggles that Georgia have had offensively, especially inside the 30-yard line, I wouldn't feel very good if I was a Bulldog fan and we didn't get some points out of this drive.
J.J. Green, 7 yards deep, lost his footing. He wanted to bring that thing out. It's been a year of what might have been for Georgia. 6 games of over 500 total yards on offense. 2 for 4 against top 10 opponents. They lost by a combined 8 points. And Aaron Murray was the capper. They lost him to an ACL injury that ended an exceptional career. Set all kinds of Georgia and SEC records. The one thing missing from his resume was a conference championship. Mason takes over from the 25, fake to Gurley. Mason over the middle, incomplete. That's going to draw a flag.
Well, Leroy Alexander is still down. Luckily for Georgia, number 27, Rhett McGowan, bounced up pretty quickly. But this is one of those plays when you look at the targeting rule, and we'll take a close look at this one very slow, and let's hope that Leroy Alexander is okay. You know, a lot of this targeting rule is not just for the offensive player. Watch if he ducks his head and launches. Yeah, that's clearly targeting. Whoa. There's two different types of this rule. One is you lead with the crown of your helmet and launch at any part of the body. The other one is if you make contact at the head or neck area after launching into the player. Well, we could not hear, but we did see the personal foul. It looked like he said it was on 18, Leroy Alexander. But the key now is let's hope that Alexander's okay. Again, this rule is put in for both players,
exactly,
not just the offensive player.
Let's bring in Craig Battaglia, who is our Pac-12 officiating representative. And this is a change in culture in the game.
Correct.
And everybody's got to get used to this, don't they?
Yes, they do. And, you know, when both players are going like that, and when they both duck their head like that, it's really tough to make a call in that situation. And hope this player is okay. But
boy, obviously helmet to helmet contact.
Right.
And remember that they review this every time.
Correct.
So would your stance be that this looks to me like a targeting call, and they will uphold both, will uphold the ejection?
Yeah, it could possibly be, but you know, when the player ducks her head like that, you know, it's really a tough deal. It really is.
Yeah, that's the hard part. You know, Rhett McGowan, as he's going down, he is going lower. And you know, the one thing, and Craig, I'd like to get your input here. Do you feel like, because a part of this rule and both rules is, does the player launch into the offensive
player. I don't see a launch there, Ed.
Yeah, you know, it's the more we watch this, I'm not sure Alexander. He does duck his head, which is not illegal.
Right.
You are allowed to duck your head. But to me, I didn't see. I don't know that it's going to matter whether Alexander's ejected or not, because from the looks of it, I don't know that he's going to be able to play. But remember, the penalty is not overturned, even if they say the targeting wasn't there.
No, and it was obviously contact to the head of a defenseless receiver. So Georgia has it out at the 40. Can Gurley get something going here? He'll pick up almost five. Chased out of bounds by Corey Cooper.
And we are double checking because the referee's mic was broken that there was an ejection again. And the report from the field was that targeting was not called. Well, look, we are just being told, and because of where they set the ball, we should have seen this, but there was no targeting call. They actually picked that up, and I think we go back to what Craig was saying. The officials come together and talk about it. There was not the evidence that Leroy Alexander actually launched into it. He was just going to make a football play. He wasn't leaning forward and launching into the player. So I think rightfully this Pac-12 crew pulled off the penalty and no ejection on Alexander. Again, watch. He never launches. He's just lowering and running through the play. If he gathered himself, dropped his hip, and thrust into the receiver, that's the part that's called targeting. And I think as vicious as this hit is, I think the Pac-12 officials on the field got it right not to call targeting. Unfortunately for Georgia, for Nebraska, it's their player who gets hurt in this.
Well, let's be clear. Even though it wasn't targeting, it is a personal foul.
Correct.
It was a 15-yard penalty.
Pardon me. Yeah, it was a 15-yard personal foul, but not targeting. And the one thing you have to remember, there are a lot of reasons to call personal fouls. And one of them is you think the player is not going to make a football-like play. And I think what they saw with Alexander was he's dropping, he's putting his arms in, not going for the tackle, waiting for the guy to cross. So that's why a personal foul is called instead of the targeting.
Nebraska was showing blitz. Mason backed off. And they go to a run play, and it looked like Nebraska won the mind game there. It appeared they changed their defensive set. And Thad Randall made a nice play from his defensive tackle spot for the stop. Now it's third and long.
Well, and this is where if you're Nebraska, you're ready for Gurley to catch a screen pass or something like a swing. One thing that they've been doing is swinging him out over here to the left and let the two receivers kind of run these guys off to the left.
They want those defensive linemen and the linebackers to think screen constantly because Georgia's so good at it. Mason underneath to Gurley. Fighting for yardage. First down and more. Gurley. Man, you could tell when he took off, it was everything he had. If that ankle goes, so be it. He's getting every bit of yardage he can on this. And one of the best for Nebraska, Ciante Evans, could not make the tackle.
And this is exactly the matchup that John Papuchis, the defensive coordinator, wants. He wants Ciante Evans, the nickelback who plays all over the field. They had him on Gurley, the right call. Gurley made a nice move, and you're right. That acceleration button's just not quite there for number three.
Boy, you got to love that kid. He's playing with great heart. For the end zone and overthrown, had a wide open Michael Bennett. Could only get one hand on it. Robert Flores has an update from the studio. Robert.
All right, Mike, surface instant replay. Check this out in the Capital One Bowl on ABC between Wisconsin and South Carolina. Bruce Ellington to the quarterback, Connor Shaw. Ellington catches touchdowns, throws touchdowns, also plays on the South Carolina basketball team.
All right, thank you, Robert. Georgia with a drive. They're down to the 26-yard line. Looking at a second and 10 after Mason narrowly missed a touchdown throw. Green moves the pile to about the 21 before he is stood up and pushed back.
Watching number 44 for Nebraska, Randy Gregory, the junior college transfer that they worked so hard to get. Every team, if you looked at the teams that were recruiting this guy, you knew what level he was playing at in junior college.
Well, it was the top 20.
Yeah, and a guy who played mostly stand-up outside linebacker in junior college, just getting used to playing defensive end, down to about 240 pounds. He'll get up to 260 or so during the offseason. He has been a load for
Georgia. Big play here, third and five. Gurley swings out. Instead, they throw to the tight end, Lynch. They have used Gurley running to the flat and Lynch running underneath patterns so beautifully in this game. Six catches for Lynch. And you notice the quarterback Mason looked toward Gurley. That influences somebody in the defense and opens a hole for the tight end.
What a terrific job by Mike Bobo and the entire offensive staff for Georgia to develop plays for guys like Lynch when you lose as many top line players at receiver and of course their backup running back and Keith Marshall. Done a fantastic job of developing things that work.
Really well designed. Douglas is the tailback. He'll get the carry. Douglas wants to throw. You might want to tear that page out of the playbook. Douglas looked uncertain as soon as he got the ball.
And that looks like Chris Burnett, the right guard. He was getting up a little gimpy, but this was excellent coverage downfield by Corey Cooper, the safety for Nebraska. And a really nice job at the point of attack there.
Wasn't exactly carrying it like Dan Marino.
No. And we just got a flag. They're calling intentional grounding. Well, here's the thing. You have to be out of the pocket. You have to see it. You have to be outside of the pocket, which clearly the running back Brandon Douglas was. However, you still have to throw it beyond the line of scrimmage, which line of scrimmage is about the 10. Let's see where this ball. Well, it got close, but I think that's the right call.
He was like close. And they're going to have to throw this one away as Mason is under pressure.
Let's go back to that one more time. The rule is the guy has to be outside of the pocket, which clearly Douglas was. And that made it a loss of down, which you go for instead of second. Well, it didn't. But the ball landed. It was just this side. It was just this side of the yard to make. So technically, I think that was the right call.
Another big third down. Mason with time floats it to the sideline, incomplete, intended for Bennett. And they will have to send the field goal unit on again. At some point, the Bulldogs are going to have to crack the goal line if they want to win this game.
And that was all about Ciante Evans working one-on-one with Michael Bennett. He was so physical when Bennett came out of his break, just knocked him completely off his route.
Let me go back to the intentional grounding call. We've seen so many times quarterbacks throw the ball out of bounds, and you really have to estimate at what yard line that might have crossed. And they give them a couple of yards here and there. If you got the ball within 3 inches of the 10-yard line, I don't know how you make that call for intentional grounding.
I agree. And you would have it really isn't that big of a loss, though, because it's just like if you'd have gone back. The loss of down is just like you ran the play, so not a huge penalty.
17-12 back after this. Earnhardt Jr. pregame. He flipped the coin for us today. Well, you just mentioned St. Augustine, Florida, and I get all happy. What a great little place to visit. 17-12, Nebraska on top of the Bulldogs. And Nebraska with a chance to run it back in the person of Kenny Bell. Flags down. One at the 10, one at the 27.
You're going to get a block in the back for Nebraska. It was awfully close.
Gee, that never happens.
Yeah.
There's at least one of those. And now our Aflac trivia question. What legendary wide receiver holds the Gator Bowl record for touchdown receptions in a game? We'll hit the Wayback Machine for this one. And he was legendary.
I have to recuse myself. I cheated, looked it up.
At least you're honest about cheating.
I don't know, is Google cheating anymore?
Apparently not, no.
Yeah, Georgia fans finally getting into it. They got Nebraska backed up, cut it to five, getting a little help.
They're fired up now. Tommy Armstrong Jr. brings them out. Abdullah out to the 10. Amarlo Herrera, the most valuable defensive player on this ball club, and they have two really good inside linebackers on this defense with Ramique Wilson and Amarlo Herrera. The crowd exhorting Georgia's defense for a stop here. Ball's loose. That is so close to a safety. It looks like they're going to mark it just outside the goal line. We say Tommy Armstrong Jr.'s arm was down outside the goal line. Watch this.
A low
right ankle.
A low hard snap. And he is down right there because the wrist hits. Remember, it's the hand and the foot. That is awfully close. But it was that low hard snap that started it off poorly. And I think that Georgia, it looks like Georgia's going to call a timeout and maybe challenge this.
I think they're going to lose the challenge.
I do too. Remember, this year, the coaches in the booth for the teams are allowed to have a TV with the TV copy going so they can see the replays and they can call down to the head coach and say, you should review this. However, watch right when his wrist hits, he's down and the ball is in front of the goal line. So I think you're right. You're going to lose the timeout and the challenge. And the key there for Georgia in a close game, of course, you don't want to give up a timeout, but you also lose the challenge. You cannot use it again if, in fact, they're going to turn it over. But I think an excellent job by the Pac-12 crew. And you think about that angle. Remember, the linesmen who are along the sideline, the officials on the sideline, they've moved down the field. So that falls on the referee to get that right. And, boy, did he get it right.
And they are going to uphold the call, we're told.
But what a big 2 points that would have been for Georgia. You go down three, you get the ball with good field position because the other team has to kick from their own 20. And the lip readers in the audience, the term was confirmed, which means that the officials on the field got it right. But that was a low hard snap by Cole Pinsick that started that off. Tommy Armstrong not able to handle it. He had his eyes up as he was looking at his reads, and that ball hit him about the shin.
Mike Batlin, our Michaelis official at this point, made the call. So now Nebraska will snap the ball a length of the football away from the goal line.
And I think you're looking at a quarterback sneak here if you're Nebraska. Just no reason to do anything slow.
And they want to throw. What a play call. Anunua. He's going to go 99 yards. Holy cow, what a call.
There is a flag down on the 42-yard line, and the Nebraska, the guys on the sideline for Nebraska, the left side, are actually kicking the flag off the field. They've got to be careful here. There is a flag down on the Nebraska sideline, 42, left side.
That could be unsportsmanlike if they want to call.
Well, yeah, and I was just watching some of the guys on the sideline for Nebraska trying to slide that off the field so nobody could see it. But yeah, so the flag was for excessive celebration. It's a celebration warning on Nebraska, not anything. I was thinking maybe Anunua had stepped out of bounds and had not established himself back in the field of play to be the first to touch it.
You'd hate to see that one come back. Yeah. That was such a courageous play call.
And the safety for Georgia just thought exactly like I did that this was going to be a run inside, and you could see the corner to that side pointing to Anunwa as he was running free, and the safety gets over there late, doesn't make it. That has to be the longest touchdown. That ball was on the, if you move that ball back 1 inch, it was a safety.
Just to send your redshirt freshman inexperienced quarterback back into the end zone on that, in that situation, and then to have him throw a perfect pass. And you could say that's the longest touchdown pass you can possibly throw. You couldn't get any closer to the goal line.
Well, the truth is, if you do max protection and tell your quarterback, the last thing you need to do is take a sack here. But Shaq Wiggins completely lets Anunwa go, and Quincy Mauger comes over and tries to go for the big hit instead of the tackle. And I think that's as close as you can get to a 100-yard touchdown in college football.
Welcome back to the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl. They're still celebrating on the Nebraska sideline, and why not the longest play in school history?
I'm just going to say the longest play in college football history. Literally, that ball could not, it was touching the goal line of Nebraska. And, you know, really a nice call by Nebraska, because as long as your quarterback knows, I got to take a five-step drop and heave it, the worst that's going to happen is you're either going to punt from your one or your three. If you ran a quarterback sneak, you're still going to be punting from your own end zone. So not that crazy of a call for Nebraska, but I didn't expect it, and obviously Georgia didn't.
J.J. Green on the short kick. Lost the ball. And they're going to be in there digging to see who's got it. How many times will it change hands when they get down there?
I've been on the bottom of a few of those, and I used to win a lot. I would use my leg, because somehow your leg would be in there and the guy's arm, and just I'd use my leg to pry it free.
Georgia hangs on. This could have finished them off.
Yeah, and for Georgia, Jay Green, not their normal kick returner, Sheldon Dawson, another guy who had been suspended along with Josh Harvey Clemens. So Dawson, their normal return guy, not with the team.
Give Austin Williams credit for knocking it loose.
And a noon one now, the Nebraska single season touchdown reception record with a 99.8 yard touchdown.
He's got a record that'll never be beaten. It might be equaled, but.
And let's go back to watch what happens as Kenny Bell is the slot receiver, and watch Mauger, the safety. He gets late over there because he saw Kenny Bell to the inside and he froze for 1 second. But watch Mauger as he turns and he's just completely out of position because he saw Kenny Bell running that post. So it was two vertical routes to that side. Really nice call by Tim Beck.
Gurley trying to get to the outside. Randy Gregory will not allow it.
And a Nebraska, that's Thad Randall down for Nebraska, who's been playing a really nice game up front, his last ball game for Nebraska. Grabbing that calf like he might be worked. We have seen so many guys with muscle cramps this year during bowl season. It's kind of like the beginning of the season. You take that time off and your body's just not quite used to going 4 quarters of full ball.
Let's go to the studio for an update. Here's Robert Flores. Robert.
All right, Mike. Update on the South Carolina-Wisconsin game. Joel Stave to Jeff Duckworth. Point after was good. Wisconsin leading in the Capital One Bowl on ABC, 14-13 over South Carolina.
All right, Robert, thanks very much. They tell the players all the time, you can't just start hydrating on game day. It's got to be all week long, and especially the 2 days leading up to the game. But we have seen it time and time again. 3:45 and counting, third quarter. Georgia's been limited to 4 field goals. Now they're down to Nebraska by a dozen. Mason, good pass protection. Again, they've done a nice job for him. Now he's flushed and throws it away. Michael Rose was putting pressure on him. We'll check in with Janine.
Well, guys, at halftime, Mark Richt told me the number one thing that they had to guard against was turning the ball over. And, of course, coming out after the half in that very first series, that's exactly what they did. And he has said, told me that the weather conditions have definitely impacted his play calling. He says guys are just not quick enough getting off their breaks. He said both teams have said that the field is a mess. But he definitely is not happy with both his offense and his defense right now. Lack of effort on their part.
All right, thanks, Janine. Abdullah is back. Makes a fair catch just outside the 25, a punt of 38 yards. Here's the answer to our Aflac trivia question, which was, which legendary wide receiver holds the Gator Bowl record for touchdown receptions in a game? And it was the great Fred Biletnikoff out of Florida State. He had four back in 1965. They probably have the stick'em in the Gator Bowl Hall of Fame from that game.
Well, they gave up the stick'em for these gloves that the young guys wear now with the tacky surface. But Inunua, has two more catches, touchdown catches to go. I'm not sure he's going to get there with just over a quarter to go to tie that record. But I think he set an all-time college football record a moment ago. It's physically impossible for that ball to have been closer to the goal line.
Abdullah on the read and the keep by the quarterback Armstrong.
Well, don't get super conservative now if you're Nebraska. They've been able to with Abdullah and they've been running that speed sweep as a decoy every time. Maybe it's time you hand it off to Kenny Bell and see if he can't get the edge.
It has certainly frozen the perimeter of the defense when they've done it. Abdullah again breaks through a hole across the 30 to the 31. They'll still need another 5 yards for a first down. Sterling Bailey made the tackle for the Bulldogs.
Really put into context what Nebraska has done with all the injuries they've had on offense. Of course, Taylor Martinez barely able to play. About 4.5 games he got in this season before a foot injury shut him down. And to get to a place where they're up 24-12 against a solid SEC opponent on January 1 bowl, pretty extraordinary job, I think, that this team did to hold together and have an offense that can win games.
Pressure coming. The ball is thrown underneath and intercepted by Shaq Wiggins. His second interception of the season and a poor throw by Tommy Armstrong Jr. That's the break Georgia needed.
Well, Wiggins certainly knew this was a stop route by Kenny Bell. Then he went to run the slam. And that ball just came out funny. That ball was supposed to be thrown way to the inside. Don't take anything away from Wiggins. Good break on the ball. But you could see Kenny Bell had to stop his route to come back to it. Armstrong just off the mark.
Let's see what Mason and Gurley are able to do after that break as they take over at the Husker 39-yard line. And they're going to have to burn a timeout here. Hudson Mason looking toward the sideline to get the call and then looked up and saw the play clock was running down. Didn't want to lose the 5 yards.
And, of course, Georgia is down to one timeout now. Remember, on the challenge that was overturned. So now down to just one timeout as we're getting into the fourth quarter. But that's something you'd hope not to do.
Really interesting game tomorrow night. Two of college football's most storied programs will battle in the Sugar Bowl. Bob Stoops, 11-ranked Sooners, aim to defeat Nick Saban's number 3 Crimson Tide. It's the All-State Sugar Bowl tomorrow night. Coverage begins at 8 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. We always talk about who wants to be in a bowl game, who's going to be more intense. And you have to wonder about the Alabama players' motivation. I mean, their goal has been national championship, national championship, national championship. And Nick Saban may be able to fire him up a little bit. Gurley Nice throw by Mason. Gets it down to the 33-yard line. They need to reach the 29 for a first down. Michael Rose had the coverage for Nebraska.
I want to reset the timeouts for Georgia. They did not use the challenge there, so they didn't lose the timeout. So that was the first of the half for Georgia.
Gurley, straight ahead power. First down. And now, down two scores. I don't think Georgia can settle for field goals anymore.
I think you have to think about going for it here. You do have an entire quarter to go, and other than the long throw by Nebraska, they've been helped out by turnovers by you. So you're right. They're close here. Plus, when you're down 12 a field goal, you're still down 9, which is still two scores. That's the big deal.
Play action fake to Gurley. Mason keeps the play alive and then throws it away.
The one thing that Nebraska has done, especially when Georgia gets inside the 30, they have locked down the receivers. John Papuchis, of course, Bo Pelini has always run a matchup zone. They run a lot of man. They recruit really aggressive, big defensive backs. And they have been sensational in the red zone. And Georgia with only 2 wide receiver receptions in this game because of the coverage by Nebraska. And, of course, the injuries to top line players for Georgia.
Quick throw complete. Rumpf, another injured player who missed 2/3 of the season, picks up the catch here.
And here
Nebraska's
goes.
Nebraska's defense is helped by those senior corners. Those guys are good. Quick play trying to get the first down. And they'll mark it at the 15.5-yard line, which is enough to move the sticks.
Well, when you add Josh Mitchell Jr. into the mix with Stanley Jean Baptiste and Siante Evans. Evans, of course, a guy who will play, I believe, a long time in the NFL, but they have just played great. And just Georgia just does not have the speed anymore because of the injuries to get open.
Mason under pressure lost the ball. And very fortunate that it fell just behind him. He turned around and covered it. That will be the final play of the third quarter. Nearly a disaster for Georgia. But right now they're down by a dozen as we go to the final 15 minutes from Jacksonville, Florida. Take a look at today's game track brought to you by Marathon. Coaches will tell you turnovers are the most important statistic in the game of football. That led to the Anunua pass to the end zone. Abdullah gets a touchdown, and then the spectacular play of the day. 99 plus. And Anunua off and running as the ball was spotted just the length of a football, literally outside of the goal line. As long a play from scrimmage as you could possibly have.
And to go back, Georgia does still have their coaches challenge. I thought Mark Richt had called a timeout, but it was the officials who stopped it before to see if that was a safety on Armstrong before that long throw. So Georgia still with 2 timeouts and their coaches challenge.
Mason with time floats it to Gurley. And Gurley will walk in. 25-yard touchdown pass. And how does Gurley get away from everybody?
Well, it was a crossing route in the middle, and Michael Rose, a freshman linebacker, it's the second time we've seen him not be able to track Gurley. But Gurley ran a crossing route with Arthur Lynch, the tight end, and that wash pulled the linebacker off. That's a walk-in.
24-18, extra point pending. Gurley with 95 receiving yards today, 49 yards on the ground on a bum ankle. Georgia right back in it, down by 5 to the Huskers. been a good ball game. We still have 14:49 to go.
From a wrist injury that hampered him at the end of the season, so just what they needed, more speed.
Yeah. Newby and Bell are deep. Bell from the five. Got a stutter step, and they'll take him down at the 20-yard line. Got a five-point ball game as we check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, you know, quarterback Taylor Martinez has not spoken to the media since he was injured about midseason. But I spoke with him before the game, and it was easy to see how much not being able to play has affected him. He said it's been extremely, extremely difficult. He told me that he actually has a stress fracture in his foot, and it's affected two of his toes. He said he's about 85% healed. He has just started jogging, and he has the NFL Combine on February 20th circled on his calendar. But it's easy to see that he wishes he were out there playing in what would have been the final game of his career today.
He really tried, Janine, as it's a quarterback keeper for Armstrong Jr. He gets up to the 29-yard line, but that foot injury proved to be just too much for Taylor Martinez, and much like Aaron Murray, probably never got the credit he deserved as a quarterback at Nebraska. Put up some great numbers.
The microscope that Martinez was under, remember, as a freshman, he burst on the scene. They started out 5-0 that year. He looked always like the fastest guy on the field, and didn't get a conference championship, but if you look at Taylor Martinez, and the question will be, can he play quarterback at the next level? If I'm drafting and I'm looking for guys with speed and athletes, I'd take him because he can run as fast as anybody. Maybe he can catch it. But I think the way the game is changing, even if a guy's only going to take 5 or 10 snaps as a wildcat quarterback and then you play him at a different position, I think Taylor Martinez, if he can get healthy and run that 40 time that you would expect to be down in the 4-4 or under range, I think somebody will take a chance on him.
Abdullah trying to get to the outside, kept his balance enough to get back to the line of scrimmage and maybe get a yard out of what could have been a 2 or 3 yard loss. Every time they move Abdullah up, even with the quarterback, it's been a read option play.
There's a bit of that sand on the side there from the sideline,
and that's dropped by Anunua. Pretty good throw from Tommy Armstrong Jr. Well, the future looks bright for him. I mean, it was low, but certainly catchable.
Pretty good arm. They're still working on his mechanics a little bit. He can be a little bit of a long strider. Tough catch for Anunua, but you'd want him to make that. And the problem here is because of the last throw that was an interception on the last drive by Armstrong, if I'm Tim Beck, maybe a screen, something very quick. I'm just not sure how much I want this guy throwing down the field up five in the rain.
Third and 9. I didn't mind them throwing from the end zone.
Yeah, well, it was the heave it up throw. It's either incomplete or punting.
Only a 3-man rush, no pressure. And this one thrown into triple coverage, and he just threw it away. So Nebraska's going to have to punt with 13:19 to go in the game, and it's only a 5-point spread.
Is it just me, or is this the first time it's felt like Georgia's had real momentum in this game?
No, you're right.
The defense is playing better. That time there was only 3 guys out in the route. Nebraska was expecting a blitz. They didn't want to get pressure on Armstrong, so they left guys into blitz, and because there was only 3 men in the route, Georgia defense had it all covered.
Reggie Davis back to receive the punt. High short kick. And it will die at the 27-yard line. 13:06 left in the game. Nebraska 24-19 over Georgia. Among the many events, the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl included a special trip on Monday. Players and cheerleaders from both Georgia and Nebraska visited Wolfson Children's Hospital here in Jacksonville to put some smiles on the faces of youngsters being treated there. And you can tell it works, and it works every time. And we are so proud of those kids for doing it. Gurley, power sweep. Got a great block at the corner across the 40 to the 45. And it was the center, David Andrews, pulling and leading a gain of 17.
Thad Randall down again for Nebraska. The series before, Randy Gregory had come off the field, their best defensive player, all Big Ten. But with Randall down, Randall's had a nice game. He's been battling. He was battling what looked like, now they're squeezing on that ankle. Before, it looked like it was some muscle cramps, but now they're grabbing that foot. But what a nice job by David Andrews on the block against David Santos right there. Santos came up, got a little bit off balance, and that gave the edge to Gurley.
And you guys love those blocks, you big offensive linemen. Get those pancakes.
When you catch a guy a little off balance, that's always nice.
Good to see Randall up and able to walk off under his own power.
When you talk about some of the people that Georgia has coming back, yes, of course, they lose Aaron Murray. But you look at when they get Malcolm Mitchell back healthy, Justin Scott Wesley back healthy, they get Todd Gurley back next year. Guys like David Andrews on the offensive line come back. I think we were talking about Bo Pelini and next year, their first year in the Big West, or excuse me, the Big Ten West division. And I think they'll be one of the preseason favorites. You look at the SEC East going into next year. Look at all the injured guys who will be coming back for Georgia, and I have to suspect that the young freshmen and sophomores get better on defense. I think you have to maybe pick the Bulldogs in the SEC East as a favorite.
Yeah, they have a chance to be a monster. Douglas running hard to the 47-yard line. Here's Janine.
And guys, there are a lot of guys coming back next year for Nebraska as well. But for the ones who aren't, the seniors, you know, none of these players have ever won a bowl game. And the coaches told us this week, two guys in particular who have been practicing like it is the final game of their careers, Stanley Jean Baptiste and Ciante Evans. The coaches said they've had that look in their eye. They really want to win this.
Evans is one of those guys, Janine, who just might be the most valuable player on the entire football team. He is so good at that corner spot.
And remembers last year in the Outback Bowl against Georgia that it was the secondary that maybe was the cost of the game, where Aaron Murray went for over 420 yards passing, a lot of them on long throws. And that has not been the case here. This secondary has been pretty solid, although Georgia's starting to get a little momentum here late.
Big down here, third and five. Four-man rush, no pressure. Mason underneath. It would have been short of the first down anyway. Intended for Lynch, and Ciante Evans was right there.
And this is a young quarterback who's going to learn when he goes and looks at the film. Stay with the route projection, stay with the tree, but watch 82 Michael Bennett as Hudson Mason comes down underneath. Michael Bennett was open on a corner route. He should have stayed in that progression. The pocket was there and looked for the longer throw.
Erickson to punt. End over end, fair catch made it to 15-yard line by Westerkamp. 36-yard punt, no return, but the Bulldogs, seemingly with the momentum, have 11:27 left in the fourth quarter. November 16th was the killer loss for Georgia. They had fought back to get a two-point lead over Auburn, but then watch this. Nick Marshall's pass deflected into the hands of Ricardo Lewis, took it 73 yards for a stunning 43-38 win. And sometimes the football gods simply refuse to smile.
And Trey Matthews was one of the safeties back there with Josh Harvey Clemens, who is not here, suspended for breaking team rules. But that long throw to Anunua had to feel eerily reminiscent to the Georgia fans, the Auburn game.
They'll start with Abdullah. He'll pick up three. Amir has had a busy day as usual.
And now for Georgia, if you're Todd Grantham and the defensive staff, you just got to think that the Nebraska coaches may tend to start to feed eight more and more and not really want to throw too many more passes if they don't have to. You start crowding that line a little bit, and then for Nebraska, if they do start stepping up, can you get it over their head?
Abdullah again piling straight forward to the 27-yard line. 23 carries, gone over 100 yards.
And I think one guy, if you look at Abdullah and you look at this Nebraska team coming back for 2014, if he does, in fact, he is a junior, if he's, you said that he put his name in to be evaluated by the NFL, see where he may be drafted. If he comes back and you get all of this time for Tommy Armstrong at quarterback, this could be a pretty explosive offense next year.
Yes, it will.
Get Kenny Bell back, a guy who can stretch the field.
Option. And Abdullah fighting for everything he could get, being dragged down by Leonard Floyd, the 220-pound outside linebacker. But Abdullah still got a couple of yards out of it.
A little dip and then bounce outside. The first couple of steps that Abdullah makes after his cut are really explosive. But watch the little shake and dip there. And I think Floyd had to readjust his right hand because he had the horse collar and was afraid to pull him down. I think that gave Abdullah another yard or two.
Mason checking the sideline for another call. Gonna have to use the timeout.
Nebraska, that's their first charge timeout.
Two big-time offenses set the stage in the Discover Orange Bowl Friday night. Taj Boyd and the 12th-ranked Tigers go up against Braxton Miller and the number 7 Buckeyes. The Discover Orange Bowl coverage begins Friday at 8 Eastern on ESPN. My question to you about that game is, who's going to play defense?
Well, you know, we saw Taj Boyd last year against LSU in the Chick-fil-A Bowl with the only better ending in Chick-fil-A Bowl history maybe last night than what we saw against LSU last year. And Taj Boyd, who had played really poorly at the end of the year against South Carolina, bounced back and played great. And Ohio State has really struggled in their secondary. Sammy Watkins and Taj Boyd, I really like Clemson in that game.
Second and 7. Abdullah, little counter move up the middle, 44-yard line. Good block up front by Andrew Rodriguez. An offensive line that had one knee injury after another this year.
And Rodriguez, the only regular starter who doesn't have an injury listed next to his name. But right now, this Georgia defense just not able to slow down the inside run. Nebraska still using the fly sweep fake.
Abdullah now up to 116 yards on the ground. That gives him 1,684 yards for the year. He gets a break on this series with Amani Cross, who got 2 to the 45. Boy, it's taking off an awful lot of time off the clock, isn't it?
I was going to say, this is exactly what Bo Pelini and the Cornhusker faithful would love to see. And you start to see the huffing and puffing. That was Jordan Jenkins there, just having the hardest time catching his breath. When you start getting pounded on with a good run game, it really tires you out, especially in the fourth quarter.
Terrell Newby, number 34, is in as a running back. He'll get the shovel pass. They scramble like it's a fumble, but that is a forward pass, so it's incomplete.
And this was set up absolutely perfectly, and Newby just missed the catch. Watch the timing and watch how much space Newby, who you can see the clean jersey, hasn't been in much in the game, but Newby took his eyes off it. Look at the blockers up in front of him. Jake Cotton working up to the linebacker. I think that's an easy first down. Now you've got a third and long.
Third and 8. Can the Georgia defense stand tall again, or can Nebraska continue this drive and work the clock? Mason pressured out of the pocket, trying to run for it, and he's not going to get there. Excuse me, Armstrong.
Terrific. Both of these secondaries on third downs in this second half have both been playing terrifically well. That time, Nebraska deciding to move the pocket for Armstrong, so you limit the field. There's only two receivers to that side. But Georgia had both guys to that side, including Anunwa, completely blanketed.
Damian Swan waits inside his 20 for the kick of Sam Fultz. Gets off his best kick of the day, a beauty. But it takes a bounce forward and goes into the end zone. A 54-yard kick. Georgia will start from its own 20 in a 24-19 game. Our technical director, Kevin Wilkinson, chronicling our travels throughout the year. Still photos of the 15 different stadiums we visited this season. 17 games in the last 4 months plus. And thank you to our technical crew who worked so hard to bring you the sights and sounds of college football this year. We're with you from the TaxSlayer.com Gator Bowl in Jacksonville. Screen to Gurley. Diagnosed very well by Nebraska this time. Seventh catch for Gurley out of the Georgia backfield.
It's really, you have to keep in context how shorthanded this Georgia offense is. When I started studying them this week, getting ready for the game, just amazing how much speed they lost at wide receiver. This was an offense that could stretch the field with Malcolm Mitchell and Justin Scott Wesley, but with those two guys out, everything has been, especially in this game, around the line of scrimmage in the pass game.
Slant caught at the 30-yard line by Chris Conley. That'll be enough for a first down as they mark it right at the 30, the nose of the ball across the stripe.
Conley, a guy who missed some time this year with an ankle injury and then injured his ankle in bowl practice. And Mark Richt said, if he's out there playing, I promise you, he is in a lot of pain. You can see he's not quite 100%, but good catch there, good throw by Mason on the slant.
Fake to Gurley. Wide open, Bennett. And Bennett down to the 22-yard line. Nice throw by Mason. And how did Bennett get that open?
Well, just like Nebraska, or excuse me, Georgia, when they lost sight of Enunwa, there was a slip at the line of scrimmage. Stanley Jean-Baptiste was in man coverage. And when he went to make a hit on Bennett, he whiffed and fell down. And you could see the safety, Corey Cooper, running down for his assignment. So there's no safety over the top. You play man and you slip and fall, get a big play.
That's why I ask you these questions. Thank you for the answer.
But because and it's because Nebraska feels very confident right now that they're not going to get a ball thrown over their head. So they're able to play more man coverage. But Stanley Jean-Baptiste, a senior, is having a great year, just slipped and fell. But this is where Georgia has not been very good. They have not been able to get Gurley going. They have the other runner in there.
Mason short arms a little bit, dropped by Lynch. A little behind him, but catchable.
Yeah, just a drop, and you expect Lynch to make that. Now, third and 10. You know, the way this clock is going and the way this game is going, I'm not sure a field goal is going to do anything for Georgia here. So third and 10, I'm not sure you need it all, because I think you've got to consider going in four downs here to try to get to seven, not, or even eight with a two-point conversion.
Field goal, you may not get the ball back. Green trying to get to the outside and does. J.J. Green dragged out of bounds at the 14, maybe the 13-yard line, needed to get to the 12.
And I
don't think there's any doubt.
Yeah, and I love the call, because if you know you're going to go for it on fourth, you can be a little conservative there. David Andrews gets another great block pulling from his center position. Now you get Gurley in, and you if you're Nebraska, you have got to think Gurley's getting this ball, don't you? So maybe there's some type of play fake for Georgia.
Three wide receivers to the far side. Gurley offset with Mason. I'm going to leave in the hands of Mason. He throws over the middle. Looked like a complete pass, but Wooten dropped it after he hit the ground. Rantavius Wooten blasted by Andrew Green. The throw was perfect. He made the catch, but Wooten was unloaded on by Green.
Green, one of those seniors that Janine mentioned, that's 0-3 in bowl games. Of course, they gave up big yardage last year to Georgia. But let's take a look to see if Wooten, what a great read by Green.
You must maintain possession of the ball all the way through the catch.
That is not a catch.
Did not.
No. What a great play by Green. And now for Georgia, the way that Nebraska started running the ball on that last drive, you got to start getting worried if you're ever going to get the ball back.
Abdullah. You see a big dose of him. He'll pick up a couple.
And if I'm Nebraska, just nothing risky here. Absolutely nothing risky. Abdullah would be my guy until, and I would try to get these, I would try to get Georgia to burn these timeouts as fast as I could as well.
Fans, we hope you'll tune into ESPN3 for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One. That's immediately following this ball game. Fake the fly sweep, give to Abdullah again. They'll take it out to the 20. Georgia has two timeouts left. And just used one here. Or did they?
No, I believe it was an equipment timeout.
It was a player lost a helmet, and that was Herrera. So he'll have to come off for a play. Huge third down here, third and four.
And on this for Nebraska, it's not about burning clock. It's about that first down. So they have shown that they're very confident in Armstrong in this shotgun with routes down the field.
Four-man rush. The pass wide of Anunua. And they'll have to punt the ball away with 3:33 to go in the game.
You know, for Todd Grantham, the defensive coordinator for Georgia, this has not been a great year. But if you look at their win against South Carolina, their win against LSU, their win against Georgia Tech, in each one of those games, even though their defense didn't play great, they made stops when they had to. And that right there, I think you could put in the category with Georgia Tech, LSU, and USC. When they needed a stop, they made it.
Since throwing that 99-yard bomb for a touchdown, Armstrong is 0-for-5 with a pick. And there's going to be a motion call against Nebraska.
False start, offense number 6. 5-yard penalty, Maine's fourth down.
So you can forget field goals from here on in. It is score a touchdown or nothing for the Bulldogs. Only 3:32 left. Reggie Davis is the deep man, and Fultz will punt. He'll catch the ball standing at his goal line. And it'll let this one bounce, and it'll cost him 6 or 7 yards down to the 38-yard line. Capital One Bowl Week continues with the granddaddy of them all, number 4 Michigan State, number 5 Stanford, seeking back-to-back Rose Bowl wins. The 100th Rose Bowl game today. Coverage starts at 4:30 Eastern on ESPN. It's all part of Capital One Bowl Week. Well, do or die here for Georgia.
Isn't it? And here is where, if you are a Georgia fan, you get to see what Hudson Mason can do, how he can operate. Obviously played very well to dig Georgia out of a 20-0 hole against Georgia Tech at the end of the regular season. But if you're Nebraska, with those two timeouts, you cannot let them tick this clock down and get the touchdown.
Down the middle, Conley makes the catch, takes a shot and holds on. He was drilled by Cooper. Big time catch, big time throw by Mason, a gain of 29.
How many plays has Conley made here in the second half to help Georgia out? A guy who was not even expected to play with an ankle injury suffered in practice last week.
Blitz. And Mason throws it away.
Well, you don't have to have a ton of speed, which we know Chris Conley doesn't because of his injuries, to run down the middle of the field and puts a really terrific move on number 11, Green. Green was the guy who caused the incomplete pass with the hit on the drive before, but that time Conley, he may not be 100%, but that was still a pretty good move on the safety.
They'll hand it off to Gurley. There's nowhere to go. Great defense. Cooper comes up from the secondary. Ankra, the defensive end, stood his ground, and a big third down. Obviously, four down territory here.
Right. So if you're Georgia, remember what they did on third and 10 the last time was they ran J.J. Green. So with Gurley in there, don't be surprised if you get some type of swing pass. It looks like a run here, though.
They give it to Gurley, cuts it back, lost his balance, dives forward, and he dove right where the sticks are. This is going to depend on the mark, whether it's fourth and inches or first down.
It looked to me like he was short. Again, nice call, because you know you're going to go for it on fourth, and here goes Georgia very quickly. Nebraska needs to have somebody at the line of scrimmage.
Trying to push the pile, and they will have enough for a first down. It didn't look like Gurley got a great spot either.
Looked like he came up just a touch short, but because it was inside a yard, Georgia just rushed up to the line. Really good push. What a nice game by David Andrews, the junior center. Good push there. We've seen him pull a couple of times. Big, big game for the junior offensive lineman.
That used to be illegal. You couldn't push from behind. Now the only thing is you can't pull, but you can push.
Movement by the slot receiver Chris Conley.
False start, 31, offense, 5-yard penalty, Maine's first down.
Makes it first and 15 with a minute 25 left. Georgia still has two timeouts as well.
And Nebraska does as well, but the hard part for Nebraska is when do you use those? Because they still can pick up the first down, you'd waste them now.
Fake to Gurley. There's a post and an incomplete pass to Wooten. There was some contact, it appeared, when Wooten
sure
made
did.
His cut.
Josh Mitchell, who had an interception earlier, has played pretty well. But now here you are, second and 15. You've got to start thinking, what do we have that can get 6, 7, 8 yards? You have Gurley in there, although he's looking really tired. Gurley's looking really worn out, so maybe some type of screen or draw, but Mason, I think this is a pocket pass for him because Gurley's tired.
Mason has completed 21 of 38 for 320 yards.
Second charge timeout.
And Nebraska will take a timeout on defense. Now for today's Capital One player of the game, Quincy Enunwa. Why not? If you're going to catch a Gator Bowl record 99-yard pass for a touchdown, you got to get that award as well.
Now, Nebraska taking the timeout when the clock was stopped. So the only thing I can think is they just thought they didn't have the right defense in.
Right.
Because you would never burn that timeout. As the clock is running, looking like the opposition is going to score, you need time and a timeout for your offense. So the only reason I can think that Nebraska would use that timeout with the clock stopped is they were convinced they had the wrong defense and were going to give up an easy touchdown.
Second and 15 for Hudson Mason. Give to Gurley on the sweep. Blockers in front, cuts it back. Gurley will be marked back the original line of scrimmage, so it'll be third and 10.
And now, unfortunately for Nebraska, with just that one timeout. And look, I get it. If you don't like what you had called, you use the timeout and try to get set. But this is coming down to where Nebraska is just not going to have any time offensively. And I don't think with one timeout, they're going to be able to save much at all.
This is do or die.
Yeah,
you need to stop them or don't.
Yeah, I'm with you.
Gurley again, room to run, and just caught by the ankles by Corey Cooper, who may have just saved the game. First of all, what a call on third and 10. What a move by Gurley to get free, and Cooper made the tackle of his career.
And this is where you know Gurley's not quite 100%, but I also think the field conditions make a difference. This looks like all the world. Look at Gurley have to gather his feet to make that cup. That's just not what you see from this guy when he's 100% healthy. Take nothing away from Cooper. Kept his head up, wrapped up with his arms, but now on fourth and let's call it 2.5, maybe 3, Nebraska. You take the timeout if you're Georgia thinking this is it. This is the ball game.
Did you see all the green in front of Gurley? If he breaks that tackle.
I think field conditions and health. Again, I don't want to undercut Cooper. That was a terrific tackle, but it took way too many steps for Gurley to get going there. And I think fourth and three, to me, this is all about number three.
He has been the workhorse as usual.
Watch him out of the backfield. He's been so good in the pass game.
They'll send him out over the middle. They're trying to check him down. The pass over the middle, incomplete. Intended for Lynch, the tight end, and it's broken up. Nebraska will take over on downs. Should have caught that ball. Boy, that was a good throw by Mason, wasn't it?
And it's unfortunately for Arthur Lynch, the senior tight end, the second ball that he's dropped. Remember the drive before? He also had a drop. Just took his eye off it for a second. Santos was trailing, but was not close enough to knock that ball away. And if that's a clean catch, I'm not sure Arthur Lynch doesn't run into the end zone.
Just turned his head just before the ball got there, looking to see what was standing between him and the goal line. And the answer was not much.
You know, you really think about Nebraska and what this season was like for them. There was so much speculation swirling around Bo Pelini from the outside after that Iowa loss at the end of the season. To regroup, to get an absolute, not just a vote of confidence, but you knew when Sean Eichhorst, the athletic director, the new athletic director taking over for Tom Osborne, went on a radio program and again said, this is our guy. And you look at what Bo Pelini and this staff has been able to do with these injuries on their offensive line and losing a four-year starting quarterback that is explosive as Taylor Martinez to get 9 wins out of this season. That's a darn good coaching job.
You know, when I heard that Bo Pelini had said, if they want to fire me, go ahead and do it, I assumed it was said in anger. Then when I actually saw the soundbite, and it wasn't, it was very reasoned, I saw it very differently. And I tell you what, he's got this program headed in the right direction. They have never lost more than 4 games under Bo Pelini in his tenure. They are in a division that they should be able to contend in the Big Ten West year in and year out. I think they're in a pretty good situation.
And you look at the Georgia Bulldogs, how disappointing this must be, but think about all of the talent they have coming back with Malcolm Mitchell, Justin Scott Wesley. I said it earlier in the game. In the preseason magazines, if Georgia isn't 1 or 2 in the SEC East going into next year as a prediction, you haven't been following what this team has. Even with Aaron Murray out, there'll be a lively position battle at quarterback. You think Hudson Mason will keep the job coming out of spring, but Georgia and Nebraska, I think going into next year, both of these teams will be 1 or 2, I think, preseason picks in their division and their conference.
And you will see a healthy Todd Gurley. He's a monster when he's hurt. He's going to be pretty good when he's healthy. An exciting ball game this afternoon between Georgia and Nebraska. They have played in bowl games 2 years in a row. I want to thank everybody on the crew for an exceptional year, especially my partner Ed Cunningham. It was just a great joy to work with you.
Thank you, Mike.
We have just had a ball all year long. Once again, our final score, Nebraska 24, Georgia 19. Coming up next, it's SportsCenter. Thanks for watching, everybody, and good afternoon from Jacksonville, Florida.